In today's video, I'll show you all the places I visited and all the things I really loved on my recent 12-day cruise on the Great Lakes with Pearl Seas Cruises. We cruised for nearly 1,200 nautical miles, visiting 10 really interesting places on 4 of the 5 Great Lakes. I had a fantastic time seeing a part of the country I had never seen before, and I want to show you all the things I loved about this trip in this brand new travel video. My trip began by flying to Toronto, where I would meet up with the cruise ship. And what a view I had of downtown Toronto from my first class seat as the plane made the approach into the airport. I had booked the pre-cruise package with the cruise line, and that means you fly into Toronto the day before the cruise, and then the night before the cruise, they put you up in a 5-star hotel, the Four Seasons, one of the best hotels I've ever stayed in, and a pretty great way to get a good night's rest and recover from a little jet lag before the cruise. The next morning, those of us who had booked the pre-cruise package took a tour of downtown Toronto, and then we were taken to the ship, Pearl Mist, where we had a nice lunch in the ship's restaurant as the ship sailed away from Toronto and sailed across Lake Ontario for the rest of the afternoon. Towards the end of the day, we reached the south shore of Lake Ontario and entered the Welland Canal, which we would use to bypass the Niagara River and Niagara Falls in order to reach Lake Erie. Now, Lake Erie sits at an elevation 326 feet higher than Lake Ontario, so locks are used to raise the ship up like an elevator for ships, and it takes going through 8 different locks to gain that 326 feet of elevation. We had entered the Welland Canal a little bit before sunset, and it got really pretty after the sun went down and day was turning to night. We went through 2 or 3 locks before I went to bed that night, and the rest of it all happened while I enjoyed a good night's sleep in my cabin, resting up for a big adventure the next day at Niagara Falls. If you'd like to see more video of our transit through the Welland Canal, click on that link in the upper right corner of the screen to view a longer video about it. The next morning, after a nice breakfast in the restaurant on Pearl Mist, we boarded a bus which took us from where the ship had docked, Port Colborne, to one of the greatest attractions in the entire Great Lakes region, Niagara Falls. And there are actually 3 different falls at Niagara Falls. The largest of the 3 is Horseshoe Falls, and the American-Canadian border runs right down the middle of it. The next largest falls is fully within the United States, so it is known as American Falls. And just to the right of American Falls is Bridalville Falls. The border between Canada and the United States runs right down the middle of the river, and our bus had brought us to the Canadian side of the river, so from where I was standing with my camera, what you see over on the other side of the river, that's the American side. Now, in addition to just standing around and viewing the falls in all her glory, we got to go on a pretty memorable adventure on one of those boats that takes you right up to the base of the falls for a close-up view. And the first thing they do when you come aboard is give you one of those red waterproof ponchos, because you're going to need it on this ride, especially if you decide to stand up on the top deck of the boat where there's no protection from the mist that gets kicked up by the falls. I elected to hang out on the lower deck of the boat where I could position myself at a set of sliding glass doors that allowed me to poke out and get shots of what was going on outside, or to duck in through the doorway and get to the protected area inside where the people who didn't want to get wet were hanging out. And of course, in advance, I knew we'd be getting wet on this excursion, so instead of bringing my regular camera, I shot everything on this boat ride with my GoPro, which is waterproof. And I brought some lens cleaning cloths with me so that when the lens got all wet from the mist of the falls, I could wipe it off so that the camera could still shoot good video of this very memorable excursion to the base of the falls. The boat ride took us to the base of American Falls. Then we got a nice view of Bridal Veil Falls as the boat repositioned and took us over to the base of Horseshoe Falls. It was a really fun excursion that I doubt I will ever forget. I can't really recommend it for people with mobility issues, as there is a lot of walking to get to the boat from the parking area where our bus dropped us off and picked us up again later. But as long as you can walk well and stand with no problems, it's an excursion I can definitely recommend. After the boat ride, our bus took us over to a different viewing area where we could see Niagara Falls from a completely different angle. This time, we were standing at the top of Horseshoe Falls, and we could see the water coming down the Niagara River and heading right over the cliff into a gigantic cloud of mist. I'm a West Coast guy. I've lived near the Pacific Ocean for most of my life, so it was a real treat for me to come on this cruise with Pearl Mist Cruises and see all these interesting places in the Great Lakes region, like Niagara Falls. The woman you see right here in a photo with her family is my travel agent, Caitlin Gallagher, and I'd like to recommend her to you if you're interested in booking a cruise with any of the cruise lines. Now, it's not about price. Using a travel agent generally doesn't get you any better price than if you book directly with a cruise line. It's about the security of having an experienced set of eyes watching out for you, making sure you don't book a bad cabin, or even a bad cruise ship, or a bad itinerary. Someone with the experience to make excellent suggestions and to give you knowledgeable answers to your questions. I like all those things about her, plus the fact that she speaks with no accent, so I have no trouble understanding her on the phone. Visit Caitlin's website at amprintravel.com or give Caitlin a call at the number you see there on her card the next time you're ready to book a cruise. Overnight, our ship traveled quite a long distance to the American side of Lake Erie, and when I woke up the next day, which was the second day of our 12-day cruise, our ship was docked in Cleveland, Ohio, and the dock was in a very unusual location, in an industrial part of town, right next to the stadium where the Cleveland Browns football team plays. Now, on paper, taking a cruise to Cleveland doesn't sound all that exciting, but I actually had a really nice day in Cleveland. I took an excursion to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I spent several hours there and was really impressed with all the displays and exhibits they had. As you would expect for a museum that's all about music, many of the exhibits incorporate audio and video recordings of the musical artists. And of course, all that music is copyrighted, so I can't use any of it in this video, but there were two exhibits in particular that were inside small theaters and featured really well-done professional audio-video shows highlighting the artists in the Hall of Fame. I totally loved those. And I was really blown away by a section of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame that was basically a series of small studios where if you yourself had some musical abilities, you could pick up a guitar and do some jamming or sit at a drum set and show off what you can do. There was even one studio where if you were there with your whole band, you can have at it, put on a little show for the other folks visiting the Hall of Fame that day. It was a lot of fun to watch and listen to. And in addition to the big features, I even got a kick out of some of the minor things they had on display, like this old mixer board from back in the day, or these handwritten lyrics written by one of the Bee Gees. I was a DJ for quite a few years back in the 1970s and 1980s. Music has always been a really big part of my life, even though I have no musical ability of my own. So while our ship was in Cleveland, I just really enjoyed spending a few hours at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And because our ship was in Cleveland all day, I had time to walk into the downtown area for a look around, and even found a little pizza place where I had some pretty great pepperoni pizza for lunch. Here's a little time-lapse video I shot from the balcony of my cabin as our ship was leaving Cleveland at the end of the day. I had a much better time in Cleveland than I had expected. I hadn't thought of Cleveland as a place I would really want to visit, but after spending the day there, I now see why cruise ships go there. The sun was setting as we sailed away from Cleveland that evening, and the weather was really nice. A lot of people were up on the top deck of Pearl Mist, enjoying watching the sunset on this warm summer evening. The next morning, when I woke up, we were no longer on Lake Erie. We were sailing up the Detroit River on our way to the big city of Detroit, Michigan. This is a time-lapse video I shot as we made our way up the river. There were a lot of interesting things to see, a lot of heavy industry on the outskirts of town. And then as we got closer to downtown Detroit, a new bridge they're building to connect Detroit with the city of Windsor on the Canadian side of the river. And then a little later, we reached the existing bridge that connects Detroit and Windsor, which I guess they must have outgrown, hence the new bridge under construction. It was absolutely gorgeous as we made our way to Detroit, right as the sun was coming up. You're looking at the highlights of the time-lapse video I shot that morning. There should be a link in the upper right-hand corner of the screen right now that will lead you to the full version of the time-lapse video, if you'd like to see it. Like I said earlier, I'm not from this part of the country, so it was really interesting for me to see Detroit from the top deck of Pearl Mist that morning as we made our way into the dock. And we docked at the most amazing location. This is an aerial view I shot from my drone later in the day. You can see Pearl Mist tied up at the dock there, downtown Detroit in the background, and over on the right, the world headquarters of the General Motors Corporation. So it was a really great place for us to be docked, right in the thick of things in Detroit. And Detroit was another one of those places that, when I first saw it on the itinerary, didn't sound all that exciting. But my thinking on this really turned around after visiting Detroit. I ended up wishing we had much more time there. I would really have enjoyed visiting the Henry Ford Museum, and I would have really loved to have gone out for some real Detroit-style pizza, but there just wasn't enough time because we were only going to be in Detroit for part of the day. And as I mentioned earlier, I was a disc jockey back in the 70s and 80s, and I played a lot of Motown music back in those days, so I just couldn't pass up an excursion that the cruise line offered, a visit to the original headquarters of Motown Records. These two buildings you see here, which are now a really great museum, this was the original home of Motown. The building on the right was offices. The top floor of the building on the left was the home of the founder, Berry Gordy. And in the basement of that building was the recording studio, where something like 100 different hit records were recorded over the years. Now, I want to apologize. For some reason, they had a policy of not allowing video recording inside the building, so I'm going to have to use still pictures in this part of the story. And of course, all that Motown music is copyrighted, so I can't use any of that, but it was really great for me to get a look around inside the old Motown buildings, now a museum, and they had a lot of great memorabilia there from back in the day. They had a tour guide that told stories from back in those days, and they had so many interesting photographs and bits of memorabilia, like the actual hat and glove that I'm sure you've seen Michael Jackson wear, and many gold records. I also got a kick out of seeing the tape storage room, where all those original recordings had been stored back in the day. And the reception area, where artists like Diana Ross, The Temptations, The Four Tops, Stevie Wonder, Lionel Richie would have waited. But the highlight of the whole visit to the Motown Museum was, for me, to stand in the actual recording studio where all those hit records were recorded, and to get a look around the room and imagine what it must have been like the day Diana Ross recorded Ain't No Mountain High Enough right here. As a fanatic of pop music, I just loved being there. Notice that on the back wall, looking through the glass, you can see the control room where engineers and producers oversaw the recording sessions and operated the mixing board. Man, I would have loved to have been here back in those days, but being here now was enough for me. After the tour, the cruise line had arranged something very special for us, a performance of classic Motown hits by some world-class musicians. And I'm not exaggerating that either. I really mean it. The bass player had been on tour with Beyoncé, and these guys put on a heck of a show. Not the most prestigious gig for these guys, I would imagine, playing on a pier next to a cruise ship full of senior citizens, but their performance just blew me away. It was so great to hear these guys bring the old Motown songs back to life. And there was one other unexpected thing that happened during our Motown excursion. They handed every one of us a hardcover copy, not a paperback, but a hardcover, of the autobiography written by the founder of Motown, Berry Gordy. And during every free minute for the rest of the cruise, I read that book, and it added so much to the experience I had at the Motown Museum that, for me, this visit to Detroit, of all places, ended up being my favorite day of the whole cruise. I truly didn't expect that. After spending the morning in Detroit, Pearl Mist had to quickly get sailing again. We had a long way to go to get to our next destination, Parry Sound in Ontario, Canada. About 250 miles away as the crow flies, but more like 300 miles or more by boat. And that would take us about 22 hours of nonstop sailing. First across Lake St. Clair, next, up the St. Clair River, which had a lot of interesting homes along it. And I really enjoyed just sitting up on the top deck of Pearl Mist, watching them all go by. After the sun went down, we sailed across a very large section of Lake Huron overnight. And then the next day, we were on Georgian Bay, which was absolutely gorgeous. This is some time-lapse video of it from a GoPro on my balcony. Georgian Bay is very remote and undeveloped, the exact opposite of all the places we had come from, Toronto, Niagara Falls, Cleveland, and Detroit. I kind of felt like I was one of those sailors in the 1400s exploring the new world. This was all new to me. I loved seeing it all go by as we sailed to Parry Sound. Here's some time-lapse video of the very last part of our sailing into Parry Sound. A very small town, population a little less than 7,000 people. Hockey legend Bobby Orr was born in Parry Sound and learned to play hockey here. In the area around Parry Sound, there are several provincial parks, the equivalent of state parks in the United States. Recreation opportunities abound on the water or in the forest. It's just a beautiful area. Once our ship tied up at the dock in Parry Sound, I wasted no time prioritizing the most important task first, sampling the local ice cream. In spite of the fact that they have excellent ice cream on board Pearl Mist, and I think I probably had some each day of the cruise so far, but I sure did enjoy a big cone of the local ice cream from this part of Ontario. Now, docked right in front of us in Parry Sound was the Island Queen, a very popular tour boat for tourists and out-of-towners like myself. So, in spite of the fact that I had spent the last 22 hours sailing from Detroit to Parry Sound on a cruise ship, I boarded the Island Queen for a three-hour sailing around some of Georgian Bay's famous 30,000 islands. As the Island Queen set sail from the dock in Parry Sound, we had a very nice view of our cruise ship. The shot almost looks like I took it from my drone, but no. I was standing on the upper deck of the Island Queen as we sailed by. I'm only licensed to fly my drone in the United States, so in all the Canadian cities we visited, my drone was grounded. Oh, by the way, great news. They have a little cafe on the Island Queen, and they even offer pizza. My excursion on the Island Queen was absolutely gorgeous. This part of Georgian Bay is just beautiful. So, I just sat out on deck and enjoyed watching the beautiful views for 3 hours and chatting with the other passengers. Part of the fun was looking at all the amazing vacation homes along here. I'm told that people do not live in these homes full time. Most of them are only accessible by water and only occupied for about half of the year. There was something funny that happened while I was on board the Island Queen. They made a public address announcement warning us that the ship's horn would be sounding to alert an attendant at the swing bridge up ahead that our ship would be coming through. And this happened right when I had my camera pointed at some folks at the front of the ship who looked like they were from India and maybe didn't speak English or understand the announcement. So they got surprised by a very loud blast of the ship's horn. Watch this little video clip in its entirety.
The captain will now give three blasts on the ship's whistle to notify the bridge attendant at Rose Point that a large ship is approaching. After hearing the three whistles, the bridge attendant will sweep the bridge open, allowing the Island Queen to pass through.
Well, I think we should end this video right here for now while we're on a high note. Click the thumbs up button if you think I did a good job with this video today. So far, I've only covered the first 5 stops on my 12-day Great Lakes cruise, so let's just call this part 1 of the story, and about a week from now, I'll release part 2 here on my YouTube channel. In that second part of the story, I'll tell you all about what happened during our visits to Mackinac Island, Sault Ste. Marie, the little towns of Midland, Ontario, and Muskegon, Michigan, and our final destination, the big city of Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Another one of those places that didn't sound that exciting on paper, but where I ended up having a really good time. So, don't miss that video to be released about 1 week after this one. Subscribe to my channel if you want to be sure not to miss it. And leave a comment if you have something to say to me or have any questions. And visit my website at jimzim.net if you want to learn more about me and all the cruises I've done. I'm Jim Zim. Thanks for watching.